Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to The Lead. I'm Jake Tapper. Chaos and concern for Republicans on both ends of Pennsylvania Avenue today. In Congress, Republicans are reeling after Democrat Connor Lamb, Congressman-elect Connor Lamb, seemed to eke out a victory in a special election in a district that President Trump won by almost 20 points. GOP lawmakers are raising concerns about what this might mean for their majority if a blue wave will soon drown dozens. On the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue, White House and Trump administration officials are frankly worried about their jobs as well. What with the harsh firing via Twitter of Secretary of State Rex Tillerson and President Trump signaling even more senior staff changes to come, those thought to be especially in danger, National Security Advisor General H.R. McMaster, Chief of Staff John Kelly, and Veterans Affairs Secretary David Shulkin. But the president is bringing at least one new person on. Just moments ago, the White House confirming that Larry Kudlow of CNBC has agreed to be the new director of the National Economic Council. The TV personality will replace Gary Cohn, who resigned over the president's implementation of steel and aluminum tariffs. And though the president has spoken about wanting to make sure his team is all on the same wavelength as he, we should point out that Kudlow also vocally and strongly opposed Trump's tariffs, with White House trade advisor Peter Navarro telling me 10 days ago that Kudlow has, quote, never, ever supported the president on trade and is, quote, dead wrong on the economics. CNN's Caitlin Collins is in St. Louis, where the president has been touring a Boeing facility and where he will hold a fundraiser later. Caitlin, White House officials are telling you that they're on edge amid all this turmoil.
Yeah, they are, Jake. They're in an uneasy atmosphere in the West Wing, my sources tell me. They say that they feel uncertain of what's going to happen next with this string of departures and firings that we've seen over the last few weeks in the Trump White House. And staffers say that they feel that they're left in the dark and they don't know who's going to be fired next or who will be walked off the White House grounds tomorrow. And the White House is trying to downplay any rumors, any speculation of an impending shakeup in the West Wing. But there's one person who isn't. And that's the president.
A day after firing Secretary of State Rex Tillerson by tweet, sources say President Trump isn't finished with his West Wing shakeup. The president is expected to get rid of even more staffers he's said to have clashed with and surround himself with people more aligned with his style and populist agenda.
I'm really at a point where we're getting very close to having the cabinet and other things that I want.
The president isn't happy with several of his remaining cabinet members. Veterans Affairs Secretary David Shulkin over poor management and misuse of taxpayer money. National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster over areas of foreign policy. Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke over excessive spending on travel. EPA Administrator Scott Pruitt over using pricey hotels and planes. HUD Secretary Ben Carson over that $31,000 dining set. Education Secretary Betsy DeVos after a poor performance in a recent television interview, Attorney General Jeff Sessions over the Russia investigation, and even his Chief of Staff John Kelly for trying to exert too much control over the West Wing, leaving many wondering who's next to go.
This is the Kudlow Report.
Now Trump has offered economist and TV personality Larry Kudlow the role of chief economic advisor after Gary Cohn resigned over a disagreement on tariffs, something Kudlow and the president also disagreed over.
I've known him a long time. We don't agree on everything, but in this case, I think that's good. I want to have a divergent opinion.
Meanwhile, the blame game over the special election in Pennsylvania begins, a race widely seen as a test of the president's political clout, with sources close to the White House blaming the Republican Rick Saccone for being a, quote, weak candidate. Democrats have already declared victory over Saccone, with Connor Lamb holding a slight lead.
It took a little longer than we thought, but we did it.
Trump carried the district by nearly 20 points in 2016 and held a rally alongside Saccone ahead of Tuesday's race. The White House now saying Lamb won because he embraced the president's policies.
The public polling wasn't looking so good, and the president came in and helped close this race and got it to where it is right now, which is, you know, within a few hundred votes.
But at their private caucus meeting, the chairman of the National Republican Congressional Committee warned lawmakers, this is a wake-up call. A sentiment echoed by some members.
If you're just simply going to try to run on the, you know, say the president's coattails or the national environment, you could get swept up and swept out.
Now, Jake, Republicans are already circulating talking points about that race, and some of them were shown to my colleague Jim Acosta, namely that Saccone was outspent in this race, and this was a unique set of circumstances. Meanwhile, the president is here in St. Louis. He's going to tour this Boeing facility behind me with the one cabinet member who hasn't been under the spotlight lately. That's Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin, and then he's going to attend a Republican fundraiser here in St. Louis tonight, where he's expected to raise $2 million before he has to head back to a very chaotic West Wing in Washington, Jake.
All right, Kaylin Collins, thank you so much. My political panel is here with me. I want to start by playing what President Trump said about his cabinet back in October.
There are those that are saying it's one of the finest group of people ever assembled as a candidate, as a cabinet, and I happen to agree with that. Of course, I should agree with that. But I think we have an extraordinary group of people.
Well,
some people are saying, look, there have been some bright spots in this cabinet, and there have been some weak links. You just had Ambassador Nikki Haley speaking in front of the UN, being unambiguous about the belief that Russia is behind these chemical attacks that occurred in the UK. At the same time, there have been some that have put up a lackluster performance. I don't think necessarily seeing, say, turnover in a position is inherently a bad thing if it means that the president is finding folks that are more aligned with his agenda. He's getting his feet under him. But certainly you can't escape the feeling that this is a little more chaotic than it probably should be.
We're not used to this much turnover.
No, we're not. And the truth is, it can be a good sign when a new person is put in place. Certainly President Obama, President Clinton, President Bush, others moved cabinet officials out from time to time. But many served for 6, 8 years even. Certainly a four-year time serving is a normal period. Now, what we're seeing with the Trump team here is that not only does he want to kick people out, but there's a lot of uncertainty about who on earth will replace them. And it doesn't mean that they're going to be better options for the public or for getting the job done. And that's really, I think, where the concern should lie.
Well, it seems like dissent is one of the reasons that people are being booted from this cabinet, which is fine if you're running a private business. You know, get rid of whoever you want. Surround yourself with people who tell you you're great. As president, it's a little bit more complicated. You'd think that they would want someone who would challenge their decision and have a little bit more of a murder board when you're talking about policy. Not with this president. It doesn't seem to tolerate that in the same way.
Although I feel like it's less about you have to agree in 100% lockstep with the president all the time, and more, are you someone that makes the president look good? And so, for instance, you know, his selection of Larry Kudlow,
yeah,
they disagree vehemently on the issue of trade, and this is an issue that's front and center right now.
Yeah.
But I think the president believes choosing someone like Kudlow is not going to make him look bad. It's going to be a good thing for his administration. So I think he can accept some level of dissent as long as it's not someone attacking him personally or embarrassing his administration.
And listen, I just want to play this sound and have you react to it, Jen. This is a Republican Congressman Charlie Dent of Pennsylvania talking about all this turnover.
There's a lot of chaos and anarchy, and this is just more of it. This type of instability and uncertainty is really not helpful for America or for the administration.
I mean, you have to have some stability to get things done. So I look at it and I'm just like, wow, I mean, where is this going?
To find out you've been fired by tweet is not exactly, you know, reassuring in terms of the conduct of government.
Three Republicans, and certainly those are three critics of the president's, but three Republicans.
They have a point. And if you look at just the national security team, President Trump is approaching what would be the biggest moment in his presidency as it relates to diplomacy and perhaps at all with a meeting with Kim Jong-un. There's not going to be a Secretary of State unless it's a very rapid confirmation. And the guy he nominated is very pro-military action in North Korea. There's not an envoy. There's not an ambassador. He may fire his national security advisor. So we can all talk about what that means and the chaos here. But if you're a country in Asia, if you're Japan, if you're China, if you're South Korea, you're thinking, who on earth is in charge? And is this a serious thing that they're doing? Who's going to be getting the work done? And that's when you really start to see impacts of the cast beyond just the Washington debate.
And it's not just obviously all this turnover in the Trump administration and the Trump cabinet. I want you to take a listen to House Speaker Paul Ryan trying to talk about the Republican loss in that special election last night in generally what was considered a safe Republican district.
The candidate that's going to win this race is the candidate that ran as a pro-life, pro-gun, anti-Nancy Pelosi conservative. That's the candidate that's going to win this race. So this is something that you're not going to see repeated.
Do you buy that explanation?
I think in this case, look, one race is not enough to tell me, oh, this is what I think is going to happen in November. This is everything that I've decided is going to happen to every Republican. But this is part of a pattern where you've got Republicans running for offices in red states, in red districts, and they're losing. Because in part, they're relying on the Trump train to pull them across the finish line, and it's not enough. The candidate in this race, Rick Saccone, was not a great candidate. He raised very little money in contrast with his opponent. The outside groups had to come in, spend all this money on the airwaves, trying to save him. So you can have someone who was a bad candidate and also say that this is a race that should have given Republicans concern. Republicans in R plus 10 safe Republican seats should run as if they are 10 points down. I've heard from some very sort of skilled consultants on this, that everyone needs to be running scared in this cycle, because you can't be a lackluster candidate and just think it's going to be okay.
And though it is true, it's not true that Conor Lamb is pro-life, as I think Paul Ryan described him. He said he might be personally, but I think he's pro-abortion rights in terms of legislation. But that kind of Democrat, that conservative Democrat or moderate Democrat, there were a lot of them back when Nancy Pelosi was the Speaker of the House. I mean, there used to be a lot of conservative Democrats, and if there are more Conor Lambs, Nancy Pelosi or whomever could be the next Speaker of the House.
Absolutely. And because of that, so one of the reasons in 2010 that you saw a lot of Democrats lose was because of cap and trade and because of Obamacare. There was this huge groundswell. So if Nancy Pelosi ends up Speaker again, it's not an easy caucus to govern. I mean, Paul Ryan's seeing that with his conservative caucuses. So there'll be a lot to unpack from that caucus, and they're going to have to govern a lot differently than what they're talking about right now.
Everyone stick around. We got a lot more to talk about. The White House is trying to distance itself from the Pennsylvania loss. Are the Republican nightmares about a blue wave in November actually justified? That's next. And welcome back. Sticking with the politics lead, sources telling CNN that Attorney General Jeff Sessions is considering whether he should fire former FBI Deputy Director Andrew McCabe. McCabe is just days away from official retirement. He would lose his pension if he doesn't make it till Sunday, if he gets fired. An internal review is expected to show that McCabe misled investigators who were looking into press leaks. Apparently, McCabe authorized some at the FBI to talk to reporters about a Clinton Foundation probe after his wife's ties to the Clintons had been revealed. Joining me to talk about this and much more is outgoing Republican Senator Jeff Flake of Arizona. He serves on the Judiciary Committee and the Foreign Relations Committee, among others. Senator, thanks for joining us. What do you make of this whole thing of firing McCabe ahead of his official retirement just a few days so he loses his pension because he misled investigators, allegedly?
This is the first I've heard of it, so it's been a busy day, I'm sorry. But I haven't heard of it. It would seem to be a little odd to fire somebody just to deprive them of their pension unless there was just cause, and I just don't know if that just cause is there. I haven't seen this.
Fair enough, sir. This was last night a stinging defeat for Republicans in Pennsylvania. Right. What lessons do you take away from the loss of what was considered a safe Republican seat?
I think it's a big lesson. It's a lesson that you can only drill down on the base so far. We've got to broaden our appeal, and that's why I've been worried about where the Republican Party is going. We can't win statewide elections like this. We can't win in purple districts like this. So it should be a big wake-up call for Republicans.
Now, you said over the weekend that perhaps a Republican should challenge President Trump right. In 2020. You're heading to New Hampshire next week. What do you think the odds are that you might be that Republican to challenge President Trump? 50%?
No, they're long, long odds. It's not in my plans. I haven't ruled it out. But I do think and I do hope that a Republican will challenge the president, and just to remind Republicans what Republicans stand for. Limited government, economic freedom, free trade, immigration. These are things that appeal to a broader base of the party and I think can win elections in the future. But if we continue to just drill down on the base, I don't think that our electoral fortunes are very bright.
Is there anyone you can think of who delivers the message that you're talking about other than you? John Kasich, Sasse?
Yeah, John Kasich, Ben Sasse would be great representatives to for that message. There are a number of people, a number of governors out there as well. But I just think that traditional Republicans, and it's not just believing in the principles of conservatism, but it's being conservative in demeanor and comportment as well, and not insulting people, not going to a rally and hoping to appeal to a broader base to win an election by making fun of the Democrats or tamping down criticism of Kim Jong-un while encouraging criticism of our free press. These are things that just are going to make it very difficult for Republicans to win in the future if we embrace that kind of message.
You and I have talked about this before, about how during a different era in this country, during the McCarthy era, which you wrote about in your book, there were a lot of Republicans who thought that they could straddle these worlds of the indecent and the decent by just not taking a position. You obviously feel that you have to take a position. Why are so few Republicans willing to criticize things that are just on their face outrageous, like attacks, very personal attacks on Democrats, on the free press, etc.?
Well, I can tell you, as a member of Congress that gets the questions daily, hourly, from the press, whenever you get outside of your office in the hallway, it gets tiresome to answer these questions, and you can't answer them all, and you can't respond to every tweet or statement out of the White House. Having said that, when the president makes certain statements or insults people or takes certain actions, then it's our responsibility as elected officials to stand up and say, this is out of bounds, this we cannot stand for. And I hope that we have more people who will stand up and say that.
You've criticized President Trump for firing Secretary of State Tillerson via tweet. It is interesting, considering that the president's catchphrase is "you're fired," that so seldom is he able to actually deliver that to somebody's face. Why do you think that is?
You know, I don't know, but I think that somebody who has served honorably as Secretary of State for over a year deserves better. And Rex Tillerson certainly deserved better than that. I think anybody who serves the government in that way and gives it their all and maybe doesn't agree with the president on everything, and they shouldn't agree on everything, but to be fired that way without even a conversation, that's one thing that's kind of out of bounds. And we ought to say, you know, that's just not right.
Sources tell CNN that President Trump is considering replacing his national security advisor, General H.R. McMaster, so that he can build a team more in sync with his thinking on issues such as Iran or North Korea. One name being floated is John Bolton, a notable hawk and interventionist. What do you make of John Bolton?
Well, I just know that H.R. McMaster has served, I think, the president well, and the president would do well to have, if not a team of rivals, certainly people who will question some of the moves that he wants to make or will slow down to say, hey, it's fine and good to sit down with the North Korean leader. But before you do, here are the things that need to take place first. Those are the kind of things that an H.R. McMaster or a Tillerson bring to the table that I'm concerned that if others get there and simply agree with the president on all these moves, that's not good for the country. We ought to, you know, it takes more to do foreign policy than just have a meeting with a foreign leader. I'll be talking about some of these things tomorrow at the National Press Club.
All right, Senator Jeff Flake, Republican of Arizona, thanks so much for your time. As always, we appreciate that.
Thank you.
And Senator Flake will be talking about many of these themes when he gives a speech tomorrow at the National Press Club on truth, falsehoods, and the dangerous state of our politics, the way forward. Russia is believed to be behind a, quote, military-grade chemical weapon. That's what the U.S. ambassador said about the poison attack in the U.K. Will that be enough to get President Trump to go after Vladimir Putin? Stay with us. We're back with the politics lead. Let's continue the conversation with my panel. So there are a lot of people in the cabinet to talk about. One of the stories out there is, according to reports, President Trump has grown irritated with his VA secretary, Dr. David Shulkin, and thinking about replacing him with his energy secretary, former Governor Rick Perry. Your thoughts?
You know, Rick Perry would be a lot more qualified than perhaps Department of Energy for the Department of Veterans Affairs. When he was governor of Texas, I believe he passed a law that would have allowed some veterans who were disabled to write off their property taxes. Also, on a lighter note, when he was on Dancing with the Stars, he said he did it to raise awareness for veterans issues. So and he himself is a veteran. So it is a cause and a group of people that are very close to his heart. probably a little bit more than, you know, the nuclear codes.
On the other hand, David Chalkin, he's an Obama holdover, the only one in the cabinet, I think. And then he is somebody that knows the VA very well. He has gotten in some trouble with some of the travels and all of this infighting at the VA, but he does know the system very well, and that's a tough system to reform.
That's true. And I think what often presidents look at is whether they are liked or beloved even by their institution and whether how important that is. And I think he is someone that has built a rapport. He's had some controversies, but it does go back to the question of what makes Trump want to make changes. And it's things that embarrass him. And they're usually public things, not things that are happening behind the scenes or incompetence or, controversy behind the scenes. It's when things are public. And that's what puts people on the chopping block. Now, surprisingly, the person who's not in any of these conversations is Betsy DeVos, who is perhaps the worst education secretary in history, and yet she doesn't seem to be on the chopping block, so it's a little confusing.
Now, John Kelly was brought in to be chief of staff. He said it was a punishment from God to be chief of staff as opposed to his former job at Homeland Security. But now CNN has some reporting that outside advisors have been talking to potential successors for John Kelly. It doesn't seem as though his departure is imminent, but that's kind of odd that they're already talking to people about maybe replacing him.
But that's kind of odd is sort of the theme of the last year and a half, is it not? I think this is a difficult job. You saw Reince Priebus struggling to, in that beginning couple of tumultuous months of the administration, trying to figure out while there was infighting in different factions, trying to create a sense of peace. It didn't work out. They brought in Kelly to be someone who could be more of an enforcer, to really put up a sense of structure and guardrails. But even over time, factions have reformed. And with the tumult of turnover, whether it's losing folks like Hope Hicks and what have you, it makes sense that if there's turmoil on the staff and Trump doesn't like that, he's going to want to look for someone new.
Another person in getting headlines that the president assuredly does not like is Dr. Ben Carson, the secretary of the Department of Housing and Urban Development. You might remember when the news broke that a $31,000 dining room set had been ordered for his office. CNN has learned via Freedom of Information Act requests that email showed that Ben and Candy Carson, that's his wife, selected that dining room set. An email from Carson's secretary refers to, quote, printouts of the furniture the secretary and Mrs. Carson picked out. This is obviously the opposite of what the Department of Housing and Urban Development originally put out, as well as the opposite of what Dr. Carson himself has said.
Not to mention the budget cuts that that they proposed for the HUD department. So yeah, this doesn't. When they say drain the swamp, it wasn't just replace it with new furniture. This directly contradicts what the president said he was going to do.
And this, and just to compare the two statements from HUD spokesman Rafi Williams today. The statement is, quote, when presented with options by professional staff, Mrs. Carson participated in the selection of specific styles. Originally, the statement on February 27th said Mrs. Carson and the secretary had no awareness that the table was being purchased. Not how you handle a controversy like this.
No. And if we give the spokesperson the benefit of the doubt, perhaps they had no idea. But it's your job to know and to find out the facts before you speak publicly. And I'm not sure how the process works in HUD, but this has come up time and time again with this current White House, where their spokespeople will go out and say something, and then it's contradicted within 24 hours. And really how that's supposed to work is you get everybody in a room, you find out what the facts are, and you decide how much of it you can share publicly. And that's clearly not happening in the White House or anywhere in the administration.
Everyone stick around. Don't go anywhere. Will a poisoning with a nerve agent be the thing that pushes President Trump to finally say the one thing he has refused to say so far? Stay with us.
Let me make one thing clear from the very beginning. The United States stands in absolute solidarity with Great Britain. The United States believes that Russia is responsible for the attack on two people in the United Kingdom using a military-grade nerve agent.
Some breaking news now. United States Ambassador to the United Nations Nikki Haley going further this afternoon than her boss, President Trump, in blaming Russia for the poisoning of two Russians on British soil. President Trump said yesterday, if the facts showed Russia was responsible, then he would condemn them for it. And now, yet another death of a Putin critic this week is shining a spotlight on a disturbing trend in the United Kingdom. Suspicious suicides, sudden heart attacks, evidence of an almost untraceable poison. The British government is now asking police and the MI5 intelligence agency to investigate 14 suspicious deaths of Putin critics and Russia critics dating back more than a decade after a BuzzFeed report suggested the UK had been ignoring evidence of Russian involvement in those deaths, such as powerful Russian oligarch Boris Berezovsky, who, after he called for the ouster of Russian President Vladimir Putin, was found dead on his bathroom floor, or Alexander Perepolichny, who, after he provided evidence of alleged fraud against Russian tax officials, collapsed and died on a jog outside his UK home. Plant toxicology experts testified that traces of a rare plant poison were found in his stomach, and evidence emerged it might have been slipped into the soup he ate just before his death. That investigation request comes as British Prime Minister Theresa May took aggressive action against Russia today, expelling 23 Russian diplomats from the UK as the international community blamed Russia for the poisonings of former Russian official turned British spy Sergei Skripal and his daughter Yulia. CNN's Nick Peyton Walsh is live for us in London with more. And Nick, how is Russia responding to Prime Minister May?
With flat rejection, as always, of the accusations levied against it, and frankly suggesting that they will reciprocate, as you might expect. Now, Theresa May laid out their sanctions, the measures against Russia, after Russians basically ignored a deadline to explain how that nerve agent came to render those two people critically ill. 23 Russian diplomats accused of undeclared espionage will have a week to leave the country, and Britain is going to cut its normal relations with Russia. Bilateral relations, not sending, for example, officials or the royal family to the World Cup in Russia later this year. And there'll be a lot of tweaking to legislation, extra powers given to crack down on what they refer to as Russian state assets that may cause UK citizens harm. But the devil really is in the details of those later legislative changes. They need to have serious teeth because, frankly, what we heard from Theresa May today was, well, effectively halving the size of the Russian embassy here and stopping conversations with Russia, which are always going to be fraught after this incident. We have to wait and see whether these new extra powers genuinely make Moscow feel uncomfortable, because you might say that Russia will simply respond in kind and kick a number of British diplomats out. So it really depends how the weeks progress ahead now as to whether this is really felt. She's under great pressure to respond tough, as you said, after these other cases where they've been blamed of not doing enough to investigate.
Jake. What about Britain's allies? Where are they?
We've had a lot of supportive rhetoric from European allies, some mentioning Russia to blame, some not. We've just heard, as you saw there, from Nikki Haley at the UN, the US ambassador there, for the first time, levelling, quite frankly, the US accusation that Russia was behind this attack. But what do they actually do? Solidarity is no use unless people are joining together and taking cohesive action against Russia. Economic sanctions will be something very unpopular for Europe to swallow. As you've known yourself, the White House have a kind of a questionable relationship in terms of cracking down on Moscow. So that is the big question moving forward. I can imagine tonight in Moscow they're hearing what Theresa May said and thinking, is that really all you've got? And waiting to see if the legislation genuinely bites, because until now this is not the international community responding, but Theresa May, frankly, trying to look tough on her own. Back to you.
All right, Nick Peyton Walsh, thank you so much. My panel is back for more on this real-life spy story. So BuzzFeed UK did this story that really got a lot of attention with members of parliament calling for an investigation in the deaths of 14 individuals in the UK claims that the Russians have been acting basically with impunity.
Yes, and I think Nick raised some really important points there, though. Look, Nikki Haley gave a strong statement, but in the bizarre world we live in with this administration, she doesn't necessarily speak for the president and doesn't even speak for the United States necessarily in terms of White House policy. And it really is a question of what happens from here. As he also pointed out, Europe had to be dragged to the table to do sanctions on Ukraine. They're not going to really want to take financial steps if they don't have to because of their trade obligations, their trade benefits. So, you know, this is a case where, frankly, this is scary. And what should scare people is that, you know, the United States is not out of the realm of places where the Russians could go after people here who threaten them, whether it's spies or just individuals. And the UK is an example of a place we should look at and think, well, that's scary. We should be doing something about it. And it's unlikely that's going to happen right now.
I want to play two pieces of sound. The first one will be Nikki Haley today, and the second one will be President Trump yesterday. I just wanted people to hear the differences. Let's start with Nikki Haley just blaming Russia just this afternoon for those two poisonings on UK soil.
We take no pleasure in having to constantly criticize Russia.
but we need Russia to stop giving us so many reasons to do so.
Theresa May is going to be speaking to me today. It sounds to me like they believe it was Russia, and I would certainly take that finding as fact. And as soon as we get the facts straight, if we agree with them, we will condemn Russia or whoever it may be.
So he says, as soon as we get the facts straight, if we agree with them, we'll condemn Russia. I guess if I'm Vladimir Putin, I think, well, who cares what Nikki Haley says? The president is waffling.
To me, that actually sounds like he just hadn't been properly briefed yet, which is a problem. But that's more of what that sounded like. It didn't sound like he was saying, I don't think Russia did it. I've been shown evidence, and I think that evidence is bad. It is certainly strange and has been strange for a long time that President Trump always seems to be a bit more reluctant to criticize Vladimir Putin,
to school
especially
every day
when he is
one
not the
place
sort of
where
president
they are for
who shies away from conflict. But consistently, since his administration took office, whether it's documents put out by the National Security Council, whether it's the statements of Ambassador Haley, they have consistently been tough on Russia. It's really only been the comments of the president himself that have at times ever been a bit waffly on this topic.
I mean, the president has been more critical of Meryl Streep and the cast of Hamilton than he has been of Vladimir Putin. That's just a fact.
And rightly so. No, I'm kidding. but to Jen's point, this is what the Tillerson was very, his words were very tough on Russia. Nikki Haley, and then there's the president. And because of this, I mean, the world is watching, right? And the messages that they're sending out, it's not just you know, the American public, it's the world. And if the United States isn't tough on Russia and isn't putting that tough foot forward on Russia, what's to keep them from, you know, misbehaving elsewhere?
Do you think that it's possible that he was just not adequately briefed yesterday and that he meant to be delivering a more strong statement, or do you see this more as a piece of he's reluctant to criticize Putin?
It certainly is possible. However, it's more consistent with his past statements to be a little waffly on it and leave himself room. And I think the problem here is that it's not just about condemning and comments that are made, it's also about action taken. And other countries in the world, Europe, other parts of the world, are not going to take action on Russia unless the United States does. And there's no clear evidence or path that looks like we are going to. So whether it's sanctions in relation to this or intervention into elections, the rest of the world is sort of halted until we do. And that's I think that's a problem.
And speaking of intervention in elections, there is this dispute between the Republicans on the House Intelligence Committee and the Senate Intelligence Committee, Democrats on the House Intelligence Committee, and the intelligence community on whether or not Russia's intention was to help President Trump or help Donald Trump during the presidential election. What do you make of all this?
I think it's fascinating the differences between the House and Senate Republicans, because by all accounts, the Senate investigation is continuing or is proceeding with much less controversy around it. And again, it's being led by Republicans in the Senate. And even on the House side, you have folks like Trey Gowdy, who have had a sort of a different view than what has come out from, say, Devin Nunes on this. Overall, I think it's unbelievable that we would still be discussing whether or not Russia wants to create chaos throughout established market democracies around the world. It is clear that Vladimir Putin loves it when countries like the United States, countries like Britain, are going through turmoil, have chaos, that the public is being sort of stoked to